Good morning, and thank you so much for joining us this morning. We hope that you enjoyed Sabbath school and Bible study this morning at 10 a.m. If you missed it, no worries. We'll see you next week. We hope everyone is healthy and ready to worship this morning. We hope you've had a great week, but if you haven't, we're glad that you are viewing this. We pray that you will be blessed with hope and a message of love this morning. So you can go ahead and start texting right now. If you have any prayer requests, if you have any praises, I've already gotten a praise this morning. I love when we get just as many praises as we do prayer requests because we want to praise God too. He's always with us. So you can start texting those right now at 470-228-2111. They're going to come straight to my phone. And then when we have our prayer time today, we're going to share those prayer requests and those praises so that we can come together as a community in prayer and just lift up the name of our Heavenly Father. So without further ado, Pastor Wanfer, are you there?
I am. Good morning, everyone. How are you guys?
Good morning. We're wonderful. Thanks. How are you?
I am good. Today we're excited. We have a special guest today speaking to us, but we also get to talk to each other and see each other pray, sing. So what an awesome day today to sing and worship God in the midst of everything. So let's sing. I'm ready.
I'm ready too. Ben Howe family, lead us in song.
Hymn 195, Showers of Blessings.
Lord of his love.
Thank you so much, Banhao family, for that beautiful gift of music that you share with us that prepares our hearts for worship. I don't know about you, but I always want more about Jesus. And there are also other people who need to hear as well. So if you could, right now, if you could like and share this online streaming and share it with people who need to hear more about Jesus, that would be awesome, especially in the world that we're living in right now. We just want as many people to hear about this message of hope and love, and that there is salvation for them found in Jesus. We're going to move on to our children's story, and we actually have kids that will be sharing the story with us today. Thank you so much to Angel and Sebastian. They're going to give us our children's story this morning. So please listen and be blessed.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. So today I want to discuss about keeping a right idea inside of your heart. You could technically say that this is similar to what's happening right now. So I'm pretty sure we're all familiar with the story of Moses, right guys? Anywho, back then when Moses had just gotten out of Egypt along with the slaves of Egypt, they had stopped like near a really big mountain. Gianna, do you know that mountain? So back in that time, that was just about the same mountain that Moses had stopped to get the Ten Commandments. And the Ten Commandments were basically two big stone tablets or like signs. And when he had carried those two big stones down the mountain, he had come back to see all the Egyptian slaves begin to party with beverages, food, and gold. They had melted some of this gold into what was formed into a golden calf. So what they had done was made a fake god, even though Moses had just gotten them out of Egypt with the help of our God. Moses was very disappointed to see what happened when they had gotten back to the bottom of the mountain. And that's basically all we have to do during times like these. We have to keep the right idea inside of our heart and just keep obeying chaos. Thank you. Happy Sabbath.
I don't know about you guys, but I love that we are having our younger members sharing messages of hope and worshiping with us and singing. If you're a young person and you have a children's story that you would like to share, could you let Pastor Wanfer know, or Janet or Gina or anyone? You can let Josh and I know. We love when our young people are wanting to be part of the worship team as well. Right now, we're going to go into our prayer time, a time where we can all participate. And I just wanted to share with you, this is an awesome, awesome praise. We heard from Larry Willis this morning. I just want to read, praise God for a good report this week from the doctor at my first checkup after cancer treatment. The cancer is gone. And so our prayers are answered, and we just want to praise and lift up the Lord right now because Larry's cancer is gone. We know that we serve a God who is capable of anything. There is nothing that is impossible to him. And so we just want to praise God. You can continue to send your prayer requests right now to 470-228-2111. And if I get those prayer requests after our prayer time, I'll go ahead and share any prayer requests or praises that we have right before we do our rundown today after the sermon. I'll also share with you, if you guys could please pray for Kathy Gossett. I know that she has an appointment coming up on June 9th. Please keep her in prayer with the health issues that she has been having. Joanne Allen said, praise God for Pastor Wanfer and his leadership and dedication, for sharing his thoughts and leading us to a deeper prayer life during these 40 days of prayer. Awesome. Thank you so much, Joanne. And if you haven't signed up for the 40 days of prayer, it's not too late. You can still sign up. So please let Pastor Wanfer know if you want to sign up for that. They've really been amazing and awesome. And it's just another way that we can continue to draw closer to God right now while we are not together worshiping together. Just remember that we're still a church, even though we're not meeting in a building. the church is not a building, it's people. And so we continue to be a church. If you guys could please, last week we talked about Beth Smith. She had passed on, that Grace DeLita had passed away. Please pray for her family. Continue to pray for them, and also for our Jim and his sister Mary, whose dog Daisy passed away. And if you guys could also please pray for those that it has been very, very difficult during this time that we haven't been able to meet together. Please just keep those people in prayer that are really, really struggling right now with not being able to come together as a community. And just pray that the Lord really comforts them and gives them peace right now during this time. So we're going to have our 5 minutes of prayer in our homes right now. If you could please gather with your family and pray for the prayer requests and lift up praises to God for what we've heard. If you have your own prayer requests, again, you can go ahead and text that number right now and I will share them. And then we're going to come back after our 5 minutes and Jim Morris is going to lead us in prayer together. Thank you.
Good afternoon, church family. It's good to be here. It's a honor and a privilege to have our family prayer. Just pray that each and every one that, to pray with me, and we'll thank the Lord for all the wonderful things he's been doing for our church and our church family, and just thank you for this opportunity. Dear Heavenly Father, we humbly bow before you with praise and adoration in our hearts, dear Lord, thanking you and praising you for the wonderful things that you're doing for us each and every day through these trying times. We thank you, dear Lord, for the progress on the church, dear Jesus, and we can't wait to all join here together to worship you in spirit and in truth, dear Lord. Oh, dear Jesus, we just thank you and praise you for our church and the love that we share in our church with one another, but most of all, the love that we share with you, dear Jesus, and pray that our love for you continues to grow throughout each breath we take, that we may learn to love you with every fiber of our being. Dear Lord, we just continue to place ourselves in your hands and at your feet. Pray that your will be done in our lives, not our will, but your will, dear Lord. For without you, we can do nothing. Dear Father, we just want to lift up our loved ones to you that maybe are far from you, dear Jesus. And pray, dear Lord, that the Holy Spirit brings strong conviction on their hearts and their minds, dear Lord, that they may surrender all to you before it's eternally too late, that we may all be together in heaven without the loss of one, dear Lord. Dear Jesus, we just thank you so much for hearing and answering our prayers and for providing for us and for always being there. Please be with us until the day that we can come together in our church, dear Lord, and worship you in spirit and in truth as a church family, dear Lord. And just pray that you deliver us all from this terrible coronavirus, dear Jesus. Oh, dear Lord, we thank you for your protective hand on us, dear Jesus. And we just can't thank you enough for all that you are and for all that you do. We praise you and honor you and glorify your holy name. For you are our great God Almighty, and there's none that stands beside you. It's in your precious name I pray. Amen.
Presents Taste and See. The story for today: God never fails.
My name is Milton Fish. In 2004, I was a pastor in the Illinois Conference until one day something unexpected happened. Ruthie, I just got back from the conference office, and the conference president told me that you're not going to be able to be reemployed there anymore. It isn't poor performance. Actually, 17 of us were let go, and 500 all across North America. So during this difficult time, we're going to have to trust in the Lord more and more.
Wow. That's right. I know God will provide. He's always there, and he sustains us through it all.
Some days later, some compassionate church members tried to find a solution for our situation. Hello?
Hi, Pastor.
Hi, John. How are you?
Good, good. I'm calling you because we've been talking with some other members, and we just want to give you our tithe directly.
Oh, John, that is so sweet, and please convey to all of the members that this is not the right thing to do. If I take the tithe, it will be less for the pastors who are currently employed. I really appreciate that, but tell the members please not to do that. Okay?
Okay, Pastor.
Finding work at that time was very difficult, even outside of church employment. So I took on 4 different jobs. Some of the jobs that I did at that time included working as a ranch hand, doing after-school tutoring, working for a hospice organization, and working in a doctor's office. We always put tithing and offerings first. We always made sure that that was taken care of, and God has been true to His promises that He will take care of us if we put Him first. During those months that I was not employed as a pastor, our house payments were almost $2,000 per month, since we lived near the Chicago area. All that time, God blessed us and we never missed a house payment, and we were able to pay our bills. Once, when I was wondering where our money was going to come from, a letter came to our house addressed to us, but with no return address. I opened it up, and there were 5 $100 bills. You know, you shouldn't send money through the mail like that, but whoever did took this risk to help us. It was truly amazing how the Lord took care of us during those 14 months. Eventually, the Montana Conference hired me as a pastor of the Glendive Seventh-day Adventist Church District, where I worked until retiring here in Ooltewah, Tennessee, where we currently live. It was wonderful to see how God took care of us. He blessed us so abundantly. God will never fail. He never failed us, and He will never fail you. Taste and see.
Now let us prepare to be faithful to God with our tithe and offerings.
Hey guys, thank you so much for your faithfulness in tithes and offerings. Thank you for giving online. For many of you, it's been a new experience, I know. And for those that have called Jennifer and just figured out how to do it, thank you for your faithfulness. Because of you guys, we are able to continue to do many things, not just here in Gainesville, Hull County, or in Georgia, but around the world. Thank you for your faithfulness. Today, for Hands and Feet of Jesus, we are actually going to change it up. Today, it is a call for us to be the hands and feet of Jesus. As we've been calling and talking to different people, we've realized that there's some people that live by themselves. And I don't know about you guys, but we're about to hit the 3-month mark of just being isolated or in different places. And so especially for some of our wiser members in the church, it's been really hard because they don't get to see anyone. Their family lives far away and they live by themselves. So we want to do the Gainesville Seventh-day Adventist Parade. Let's go for a ride. We want to be able to drive by their homes and just with signs and markers that you will make and just drive by their house and just say hi. And the more cars, the better. So June 14, we want to meet at the church. If you would like to participate, we hope that you can. So June 14 is a Sunday, not tomorrow, but the Sunday after here, we're going to go for a ride. So we're going to do a parade for our members. We want to visit those that have been shut in for a while, haven't seen some of us. We want to visit those that that are missing church and can't come for the ride. And then we also want to try to visit those that have graduated from high school. So we can say congratulations on this achievement. We want to continue to be the hands and feet of Jesus right here in our community as we continue to figure out how to move forward. The church does not stop because the church is you and me. So June 14, make plans. Start getting a couple of poster boards and start making your signs that says, hi, we miss you. Congratulations. We love you. So June 14, we will meet in the church parking lot. Bring your masks if you want to talk to other people, or you can talk to each other from, you know, the car window. The other thing that we wanted to talk about is the 40 days of prayer is right here. Especially for families, hope you guys are doing good, but here, I know you guys can't see, but this is the ones that we're doing for, we're doing the prayer chain. And so we're putting them like this, and we're going to keep locking them up. And then in our family, what we want to do is after the 40 days have gone, we want to collect them together and burn them, just saying, God, thank you so much for not just answering our prayers, but for listening and speaking to us. It's still not late to sign up for 40 days of prayer. Just leave us a comment right below that says, hey, I want to sign in. And then do me another favor. Just let us know if you want all the other readings that we've done so far. But we want to unite together as a family, because it is not the building, it is you and I together with the Spirit of God that will make sure that we come back, not just to a church building, but as Holy Spirit-filled people that will make sure that the building glorifies God. Today, you do not get to hear from me. I know, it's been 3 months listening to me every single day. And maybe you guys were not tired, but I needed a little break. And Pastor Neil is preaching to us today. The topic of his message is God still out there? Thank you, Pastor Neil. Pastor Neil, for just speaking to us today, speaking to our hearts. I know I am thankful. I am ready to just turn around and watch you right here. And I invite you that as we continue to do this, that we listen to what God has to say to all of us today. Also, if you're a church member, don't go afterwards, because we have a couple of other announcements that we want to share. But before we go into the sermon, we have a special music. Thank you so much for sharing with us. Pastor Neil, thank you also for sharing the word of God today. Have a happy Sabbath, and we'll see you guys in just a couple or a few minutes right after the sermon. Each day.
Good morning. I count it all joy to be joining you on this beautiful Sabbath day. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I wish to affirm the ministry of Pastor Juan Ferman Salve for the awesome work he's been doing as pastor of your congregation. I know that in the last several months, he has been tested and tried even by fire. Thank God, in the end, he'll come forth by God's grace as pure as gold. I wish to bring greetings on behalf of Georgia Cumberland Conference, our 40,000 members in Georgia and the state of Tennessee, and one county in North Carolina. Today, we are worshiping together in the beauty of holiness, and I pray that God will bless our time together. I also want to thank Audrey Malcolm for sharing that beautiful rendition as it relates to preparing our hearts for the presentation of the Word. And you'll be hearing from her again at the end of this worship experience. The title of our message this morning is God out there? Is God out there? Let's pray. Father, speak and let your servants hear. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. A famous professor on the first day of class shocked his students with this statement. He said, "I can prove that God does not exist. I can give you evidence that there is no God." That's what he said. Can you imagine the looks on the faces of those students? Turning his head heavenward and pointing his finger to the ceiling and the sky, he shouted, "God, if you are real, I want you to knock me off this platform in the next 15 minutes. Knock me off this platform." There was a sudden hush in the lecture hall as the students looked at each other in amazement. You could have heard a pin drop. 5 minutes went by, leaving only 10 minutes for God to prove himself. He pointed his finger again to the sky. "Lord, if you're out there, knock me off this platform." 9 minutes went by. We're down to the last minute, and he started counting off. 50 seconds, 40 seconds, 30 seconds, 20 seconds. Suddenly, and without warning, a United States Marine, a soldier, got up out of his seat, rushed towards the professor, folded his super-sized fist, and leaning back, he punched the professor in his face, knocking him to the ground. The poor professor stumbled, fell backwards, and crashed on the hard, cold concrete. The standing students dashed to the front of the classroom, anxious to see what had become of their professor. After several moments, the professor awoke from his sudden sleep, raised himself up to his feet, brushed off his clothes, and staggered back to the platform. Turning around, he faced the soldier, pointed the same finger that he pointed to heaven, and he said to the Marine, "What's the matter with you? Why did you do that?" The soldier replied to the professor, "God was busy, so he sent me. God was busy, so he sent me." Is God out there? Is God still out there? Is there a great throne in heaven, and is it occupied? If God is sitting on the throne, is he awake? Is he aware of what's happening down here on planet Earth? Or is he far away on the other side of the universe, taking care of other important matters. Beloved, you know it very well, that there are cataclysms and calamities and catastrophes of all types taking place in our world. There are trials and troubles and tragedies of all sorts. There are disasters and diseases, and it appears as though no one is in control. Is God out there? Let's talk for a minute about the coronavirus. More than 6.5 million people have been infected around the world. 40 million Americans out of work. Multiplied millions on lockdown, and almost 400,000 dead around our globe. Is God out there? Within the last week, we have seen on our television sets racial unrest, riots, and weeping in the streets of the United States because of the cold and callous killing of George Floyd. Tempers and tensions and tears are flowing in our highways and our byways. Princes, prime ministers, and presidents are powerless. Plain everyday people like you and me, we are stressed and distressed. We've been praying to God, expecting God to deliver us with a strong and mighty hand, but the heavens only seem silent. Saints of God, I wish to invite you this morning to come with me to the University of the Psalms. Walk with me down to classroom number 40, Psalm 40, and let's look at verses 1 through 3. There's a student moving out of his seat, dispatched by God 30 centuries ago to affirm his honor. Who is this student? Who is this soldier? It is the ancient singing soldier king of Israel. He will not raise his fist this time. He will use his mouth to deliver words of consolation and comfort about how we should relate to God during times like these. Let's look at Psalm 40, verses 1, 2, and 3. And this is what David says. I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me and heard my cry. He brought me up also out of an horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock and established my goings. Verse 3. And he put a new song, amen, somebody. He put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. Many shall see it and fear and shall trust in the Lord. When we find ourselves in trouble, there are three points I want to extract from these verses to encourage our hearts about God. Number one, God is still out there. Secondly, God is still down here. And thirdly, God is still in here. Let's take a look at the first point. God is still up there. Notice the words of David. He said, I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me and heard my cry. When Jesus first taught his disciples to pray, the first thing he told them to say was, Our Father, which art in heaven. On April 12, 1961, Soviet cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin became the first man ever to fly in outer space. When he returned to the Soviet Union, the president at the time, Nikita Khrushchev, said, Gagarin flew into space, but he did not see God. There was no God out there. But Jesus told us that our Father is in heaven, not the first heaven where the birds fly. not the second heaven with the stars and planets and asteroids and galaxies and constellations follow their prescribed orbits, but the third and the highest heaven. The song said it best, above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, he was there before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, that's where God lives, above all, exalted above time and above eternity. God is still up there. Saints of God, the devil uses two powerful tools, the tools of doubt and deceit, to discourage believers during times of crisis as it relates to God. First, he tempts believers to question the very existence of God. Let me say this, beloved. The devil should be ashamed of himself because he knows better. He knows there is a God. In James, the second chapter, verse 19, the Bible says, thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. The devil knows there is a God. The New Living Translation puts it this way. Even the demons believe that there is a God, and they tremble, they shudder, they shiver in terror. Yes, the devil knows that there's a God up there. At one time, he stood in the very presence of God. In Ezekiel 28, verse 14, the Bible says, thou art the anointed cherub that covereth. And I have set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of God. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou wast perfect in thy ways before the day that thou wast created, till iniquity was found in thee. Lucifer, whose name means light bearer, once stood in the very presence of God. His wings veiled God's glory. But today, the light bearer has become the darkness dealer. And that's why in Revelation chapter 12, verse 9, the Bible says, and the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. Beloved, when we are tempted to believe that God does not exist, shake it off. Because it's simply a trick of the devil who knows better. Secondly, the devil tempts believers to question their relationship to God. After Jesus was baptized, he went into the wilderness for almost 6 weeks, 40 days and 40 nights. When he was the weakest, when he was the faintest, when he was most vulnerable, the devil, the tempter, the old serpent came to him to question his relationship to God. Notice what the tempter said in Matthew, the 4th chapter and verse 3. And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. Another trap. Jesus knew what his relationship was to the Father, because 40 days before this point in time, he stood in the Jordan River and was baptized by John, and the Father declared from heaven, this is my beloved Son. The Father affirmed his relationship with his Son. Jesus knew that. And so therefore, when the devil came to him with that temptation, he shook it off. Beloved, I'm here to tell you that during times of crisis, when you are tempted to question your relationship with God, replay your walk with God from the beginning, and you will find times when God has revealed himself to you and has confirmed that you belong to him. You are his beloved son. You are his beloved daughter. And he has never changed his mind. No matter your circumstance, when you are hungry, you are still God's son and daughter. When you are thirsty, you are still God's son and God's daughter. When you have trouble in your mind, with your money, with your marriage, with your mission, and with your ministry, you are still God's son and God's daughter. Never doubt your relationship with God. So the devil comes and he tempts us to question our relationship with God. And he tempts us with the question of whether God exists. And the third temptation he brings is for us to question whether God really cares. If God cares, why was I infected with the coronavirus? If God cares, why is it that I'm out of work? Well, one day Job lost his animals, his servants, his health, and all his children on one day. Now, here is something I have often wondered about. Why did Satan not destroy Job's wife also at the same time? The answer, so he could use her against him. And that's why in Job, the second chapter, verse 9, the Bible says, "Then said his wife unto him, curse God and die." God doesn't care about you. If God cared, why would you lose all your possessions? Why would you lose your children? Curse God and die. Beloved, there are some people in your life whose only purpose is to tempt you and to test you. But shake them off. And respond to them as Job responded to his wife. In Job, the second chapter, verse 10. But he said unto her, "Thou speakest as one of the foolish women." And then Job arose, Job 1 verse 20, rent his mantle and shaved his head. Praise God. Come on, somebody say amen. Fell down upon the ground and worshiped and said, "Naked came I out of my mother's womb. Naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." Beloved, I'm here to tell you this morning that the solution to desperation is worship. The prescription to depression brought about by the coronavirus and racial tensions is worship. The destination before, during, and after devastation is worship. And so I stop by here to tell you this afternoon that God is still out there. And I charge you to refuse to question God's existence, refuse to question your relationship to God, and refuse to question whether God really cares. Instead, learn to be patient. Learn to be patient. Notice the words of David. I waited patiently for God. According to research, the human race now has an attention span of only 8 seconds. We just can't sit still for a minute. But notwithstanding our current realities, the Bible tells us in Psalm, the second chapter, verse 14, wait on the Lord, be of good courage. In Psalm 37, verse 34, wait on the Lord and keep his way. And Isaiah 40, verse 31, wait on the Lord, and he shall renew your strength. When you are tempted and tried, wait on the Lord. Be patient, and God will show himself strong in your situation and your circumstance. Secondly, learn not only to be patient, but also learn to trust God's timing. David said, he inclined unto me and heard my prayer. Believe me, saints of God, God knows what time it is. God knows what's going on in your heart, in your mind, in your home, in your relationship. God knows. be comforted with the fact that while we are waiting patiently in God, that God is inclining towards us. The Hebrew verb incline literally means to stretch towards. It means to lean in the direction of. So while we are praying and waiting, God is leaning towards us. One pastor said, when we pray to God, if the request to him is wrong, he will say no. If the timing is wrong, God will say, go slow. If you are wrong, if there is something in your life that is not right in your relationship with God, God will say, grow. But if the request is right and the timing is right and you are right, God says, go. Beloved, I'm here to tell you that God may be out of sight, but you are always on his mind. And so the first point I made this morning is God is still up there. Second point, God is still down here. In Psalm the 40th division, verse 2, David says, he brought me up also out of an horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock. I've got several questions for you. What is a pit? A pit is a lifeless thing. It's a hole. A sinkhole, a dungeon, a grave. That's a pit. A pit can also be a living thing. In Proverbs 22, verse 14, the Bible says, the mouth of the strange woman is a deep pit. Have mercy, Lord. So how do people get into pits? Well, some people climb down into pits. Can you believe that? Yes, they do. Out of pure ignorance. Secondly, some people fall into pits by accident. They just didn't see it. They trip and they fall into the pit. But most people are pushed or lowered into pits by people they know. Did you hear me? They are dropped or pushed into pits by people they know. I think of the case of Joseph. In Genesis, the 37th chapter and verse 24, the Bible says that Joseph was placed into a pit by his own brothers. In Daniel 6:17, Daniel was thrown into a pit with lions by people on his job, people he worked with every single day. And in the case of Jeremiah, in Jeremiah the 38th chapter and verse 6, Jeremiah was put into the pit by people in his own church. Read it for yourself, Jeremiah 38. They disagreed with what he shared about the direction God wanted the kingdom to go. And they plotted against him in his church. So what do pits represent? Pits, they represent a serious defeat, a catastrophic downfall, or perhaps even a major setback. I heard somewhere someone said, every setback is a setup for a step up. Let me say that again. Every setback is a setup for a step up. And so falling into a pit or being pushed in a pit may just be a blessing in disguise. May just be. But notice what David says. He brought me up also out of an horrible pit. Hear me, beloved. Sometimes God will use the same people who put you into the pit to take you out. Isn't that something? In the case of Joseph's brothers, God used them to pull him out. Dan, where is your brother? In the pit. Go get him out. Levi, where is your brother? He's in the pit. Go get him out. Simeon, where is your brother? In the pit. Go get him out. Sometimes God will use the very people who push you in to pull you back out. Then there are times when those who put you in, as in the story of Daniel, that they will not only be instrumental in taking you out, but they will be cast into the very pit into which they have thrown you. Notice in Daniel, the 6th chapter in verse 24, and the king commanded, and they brought those men which had accused Daniel, and they cast them into the den or the pit of lions, them, their children, their wives. And the lions had the mastery of them and break all their bones in pieces before they came to the bottom of the pit. Those who hate you, those who despise the people of God, they better be careful, because the pits they have dug for you might be their own pits. But I'm more fascinated by what happened to Jeremiah. Jeremiah had no brothers, but God assigned someone from the king's court to take him out of the pit. In fact, the Bible says that the king had a minister, a eunuch by the name of Ebed-Melech. That is a compound name. Ebed, which means servant, and Melech, which means king. Which means that the king sent one of his servants to pull Jeremiah out of the pit. Beloved, I'm here to tell you today that God has millions of Ebed-Melechs, angels, ministering spirits, who stand ready to pull you out of the pit at a moment's notice. Are you in a sickness pit this morning? God has an Ebed-Melech, a servant, to take you out. A mental health pit, a job pit. Perhaps you have lost your job. God is preparing someone to connect you with employment. Maybe it's a debt pit, or a conflict pit, a conflict with your husband, with your wife, or even with your children. God will provide an Ebed-Melech, an attendant of his, to help you process the challenge and get through those circumstances. I stop by here to tell you, beloved, that God is not only up there, but God is also down here. We live under God's heavens. Our circumstances are under his authority. Our destinies are under his direction. Our futures are under God's control. Our cares are under his wings. Our sins are under his blood. Our enemies are under our feet. Our deliverance is under his command. Gainesville, I came to tell you that God has a rescue plan for you. He says, I will bring you out of the horrible pit, and I will transfer your feet from the mud, from the miry clay, and will place them on the rock, the solid rock, Christ Jesus. And then he says, I will establish your goings. What does that mean? When God says, I'm going to take you out, I'm going to direct your attention in a new direction. What does that mean? God is going to type a new direction or a new address into your GPS system. It means that God is going to release the resources you need to advance yourself. God is going to remove the bad-minded people out of your life and put some new spiritual ones. God is going to relocate you to a new address. He's going to offer you a new opportunity for advancement, a new job, a new state of mind, even a new attitude. God will establish your ways, your new ways. And so God is up there. God is down here. But most of all, God is also in here. In Psalm 40, verse 3, and he hath put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. Many shall see it and fear and shall trust in the Lord. I heard a story that I'd like to share with you as we prepare to close. Several years ago, a London newspaper offered a large cash prize to anyone who gave the best answer to the following question. And the question was, which is the shortest way to London? Which is the shortest way to London? And they received all types of answers in by mail, by telephone, answers like by car, by bus, by boat, by train, by airplane, by the superhighway. Guess which answer won the competition? The answer to the question, which is the shortest way to London, was good company. The shortest way to London is with good company. All travelers know the truth. Good company shortens a trip. Good company makes time fly. Good company takes the fear and the fright even in the darkest night. Good company makes you feel warm on the inside when it's cold on the outside. Good company will even hum your new song with you. Beloved, God is the best new company you could ever keep. Yes, God is still up there. Yes, God is still down here. Yes, God is still in here because he has put a new song in my heart. As we prepare ourselves for the appeal to be sung by Sister Malcolm, I invite you to trust God's heart. No matter what you're going through, in your heart, in your mind, in your home, in your family, on your job, in your community, in our nation, we've got to trust God's heart because he is still up there. He is still down here. And he is still in here. Sister Malcolm will sing at this time.
All things work for though sometimes we don't see how they could. Struggles that break our hearts in two sometimes blind us to the truth. Our Father knows what's best for us, and his ways are not our own. So when your pathway grows dim, when you just don't see him, remember you're never alone. For God is too wise to be mistaken, God is too good to be unkind. So when you don't understand, when you don't see his plan, when you can't trace his hand, trust his heart. He sees the master plan. Our future in his hand. So don't live as those who have no hope. All our hope is found in him. We see the present clearly, but he sees the first. Like a tapestry, he's weaving you and me to someday be just like him. too wise to be mistaken, and God is too good to be unkind. So when you don't understand, when you don't see His plan, when you can't trace His hand, trust His heart.
Thank you, Audrey, and thank you, Pastor Neil, for reminding us that God is in control and God is still here. Thank you so much for that great message. Thank you for the opportunity to thank you for speaking to our hearts directly. Let's sing our last hymn, and then we will have the rundown of next week's events. Baha family, lead us into our last song.
Hymn 528, A Shelter in the Time of Storm.
Yeah.
shelter in a time of storm.
Awesome. Thanks again, Banhao family, for sharing your beautiful gift of music. I don't know about you, Wanfer, but after that sermon and all the music, all the worship that we had today, I'm just ready to unplug and spend time with Jesus and with my family.
Yes. So once we're done here, go spend time. I mean, we've been spending time with Jesus, but let's go just disconnect completely. Do not check Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, anything, because you will get stressed out. Mm-hmm. Open up the Bible and allow the Word of God to speak right into your heart. He is the answer. He really is the answer.
Amen. Amen. But before you do that, we have a rundown for you of everything we have planned over the next week. So stay tuned for that, and then you can go ahead and unplug and unwind. But real quick, if you haven't already, please like and share this live stream so that other people can understand what it is to rest as well, to rest in knowing that Jesus paid the price for us and he just wants to spend time with us. So if you could share that right now, that would be awesome. So here's the rundown. All right, so first things first, tomorrow at 6:30, we're going to be having prayer meeting via Zoom. You can go to gainesvilleadventist.org/prayer-meeting for that at 6:30 tomorrow night. And if you haven't signed up for the 40 days of prayer yet, you're going to love it. So make sure you text or call Pastor Wanfer and let him know that you want to be signed up for that, and he will give you, if you need, all the ones that you've missed already, but it's not too late. Tuesday, 6:30, prayer meeting again via Zoom. That same link that you used on Sunday, you're going to use on Tuesday and Thursday as well. Wednesday, I don't know if you guys were not able to join this last Wednesday, the kids loved it. So this coming Wednesday, we're having another kids worship hour via Zoom at 7 p.m., there's going to be stories. There's going to be music. The kids are going to love it. So please make sure that the kids have an opportunity to join during the Zoom meeting. They get to see all their friends and have fun and sing and just learn more about Jesus. Thursday, 6:30 p.m., again, prayer meeting via Zoom. And then we'll see you again here next Saturday. 10 a.m. is our Zoom Sabbath School Bible study. You can go to gainesvilleadventist.org/SS online for that. And then we'll be doing our live stream again at 11:30 next week. Our live worship service on our platforms Vimeo, Facebook, YouTube, and on our website at gainesvilleadventist.org/live. Saturday, June 13th at 6 p.m., the Kids Bible Quiz via Zoom. If you're interested, please let Janet Bennett know so that she can prepare and you guys can prepare for it at 470-577-0718. And then the following Wednesday on June 20th at 6 p.m., the Kids Talent Show via Zoom. You want to make sure that Janet knows so she can prepare, and also your kids need to prepare for the talent show. So if you're interested, once again, call her at that same number or text her at 470-577-0718. We want to make sure that our kids are involved as well as much as we are. Another reminder that next Sunday, we're going to meet at the church at 10 a.m. You see that red car right there? That red car is you. So this is an opportunity for you to be hands and feet of Jesus, to drive by. We're going to do a parade for our very special members that just really need to see our faces, as well as we want to make sure that we're celebrating high school and college graduates. So if you're a high school student or a college student and you graduated, we want to come by and say congrats. So, 10 o'clock or 10 a.m. June 14th next Sunday. Let's go for a ride. Just a reminder that the bookmobile is coming on June 25th. Please call 423-396-2814 by June 23rd and place your order. You can come pick that up on June 25th at our church from noon until 12:30 p.m. And we're going to have a virtual bingo night. Who doesn't love bingo? June 29th or 27th, excuse me, at 9 p.m. There's going to be more details to come, so stay tuned for that. But virtual bingo night. Also, Josh and I don't know if you guys have seen it, but we've been sitting outside at night, you know, after sundown or like even at night, it's beautiful summer evenings right now. You're able to spot the International Space Station. I don't know if you guys have seen it, but there was one night we were sitting outside and all of a sudden I looked up and I saw a bright light in the sky and it was moving almost faster than an airplane, but it didn't have the blinking lights like an airplane. We just want to let you know this is a fun activity to do with your kids, your grandkids, whoever that you're with, whoever you're living with. Spot the station, the International Space Station. Tonight it will be visible for 4 minutes. It appears 42 degrees above west northwest. And it's going to fly over tonight at 9:07 p.m. here in Gainesville. So it's an activity to do with your family. So get outside at 9:07 p.m. and look for the International Space Station. If you see it, let us know. We want to know if you saw it and if your kids enjoyed it. So that's all I have. Pastor, you have something to say as well, correct?
I did, but I'm trying to figure out what 40 degrees looks like for tonight.
You'll have to get out your little compass and figure out, you know.
I know. Going back to second grade math. Hey, yes, we had a special announcement as we kind of want to know what your plans are. So we're sending a survey today, and we want you to answer. We want to know if we open the church, are you going to come back? What are the conditions that you would consider, coming back to the church? What are you thinking about all of this? Are you just excited to worship at home and that's how you want to continue to do so? And so it is important for all of us to, as we plan what materials to buy, hand sanitizer, cleaning supplies, as we set up chairs, all of this, we need to know what you're thinking. And so this will allow us also to continue planning on how to reopen as we move forward. So please make sure that you fill up the survey, because if you don't talk, then we don't know, because we do not read your mind. That's right. We don't read your mind. So please fill out the survey. It'll go out today at 2 p.m., and it'll help us greatly, not just to plan how to come back, but to know what you're thinking so that we can continue serving one another. From our family, we just wanted to say hi and bye. Happy Sabbath. Enjoy. Have an awesome day. We miss you guys.
Yes, we miss you guys. We pray for you. We think of you and hope to see you soon.
Soon. So help us out. See you soon by filling out that survey. How about that transition there? Hey, Connie. Happy Sabbath. We enjoy seeing you guys, and thank you, Neil, thank you, Audrey, and next week we'll continue the Book of Job, and I guess I'll give you just a taste of next week. Since the devil couldn't destroy Job by sending famine, by sending destruction, then he tried the next best thing. He sent his friends. Hey, we'll talk about that next week. Have a good one. Thank you. Breaking news! I forgot to tell you where to access the survey. The survey will be available by email on the website, and also we will on social media. So do not fret, you will see it somewhere. Just make sure that you're looking for it. Check the website, check your emails, check your text messages, and also on social media. Make sure also when you see Josh and Connie, they will put a video out as well. But just make sure you go ahead and do it. I apologize for not telling you where you could get to the survey. That was my fault. But we want to hear your voice. So please speak up.